You are watching a video lesson on a brief introduction to environmental studies. I am Dr. Pawan Kumar, and this lesson is a part of Botanypedia lecture series. In this particular lesson, you are going to learn about three aspects of EVS, that is environmental studies. First, we will look at what is an environment. Then we will throw some light on multidisciplinary nature of environmental studies. And in the last part of this class, we will talk about two important components of environment. So what is an environment? The term environment has been derived from French word environnement. That means everything that surrounds us. Environmental studies deal with the every issue that affects an organism. It is essentially a multidisciplinary science that brings together various aspects of our natural world and its interaction with the surroundings. It is an applied science because it seeks practical answers to making human civilization sustainable on the Earth's finite resources. The field of study of environment science is also known as ecology. Now we will look at the multidisciplinary nature of environmental studies. The environmental studies is not just a single subject. It is an integration of several subjects that include both science and social studies. So, no matter which field of study you are in, you will find some aspects of environment in it. So, there will be some component that is related to environment. For example, if you are a botanist, and you want to learn about various cropping patterns in a particular field. So if you are interested, you would like to know what is the environment in which a particular crop grows. Suppose if you are trying to grow a wheat plant in a season which is not suitable for it, it will not grow. So the knowledge of the environment, the weather, the climate is very crucial for practicing good or suitable agriculture practices. Similarly, if at the same time, if suppose that same agriculture field is infected by or infested by some pest or the insects that feed upon the crop plants and they destroy the crop plants. So if you do not have the knowledge of the type of insects that can damage your crop, so you will not be able to successfully harvest your crop. So even people who are studying animal sciences like in the zoology, they also need to learn about various pest management strategies or the pest management strategies which can help them protect their crop plants. Likewise, if they are interested in studying about the various aspects of climate, so in case of climatic factors that they affect the crop yield, what they can do, they can study about what is the temperature. So there are different departments, like for example, who study the different types of climatic patterns. They do weather forecasting so that they can provide or disseminate useful information for general public. So there is a separate department for that. Likewise, if there is a department or there is a field of study that is looking at the pollution level, or like for example, we see that because of the increase in population, the water bodies are getting polluted day by day. Like for example, the best example is if you take the example of Yamuna, you see that it is getting very polluted these days. So in order to purify or to clean the water, so there comes the role of different industries that will come together and they can help cleaning the water. Like for example, so there are people who are from the chemistry background, they will look at what are the chemical constituent or chemical pollutants which are there. So there are people who will take the help of machines and they will devise or install some water treatment plants that will take the water and it will clean the water. So the people from the physics background need to also apply their knowledge to solve this problem. So these are just few examples where we can see that the different fields of studies directly or indirectly are related to the environmental studies. So no matter which field of study you are in, biology, chemistry, physics, geography, or economics and any other field, there is some connection with the environment. So the scope of environmental studies is extremely wide and covers some aspects of nearly every major discipline. So here on the left hand side, you can see a picture. What does this picture indicate? Different fields of studies are indicated in different boxes. Like suppose, for example, on the top right side, you can see this block represents the humanities. And in the humanities, you have many courses, many subjects like environmental history, environmental geography, so and so forth. So all of these subjects, they help us to generate world views about some aspect. Those world views are important because if we are interested in, okay, what was the history of a particular environment in a particular area, like how the climate was in 1960s and how it has changed in 1970s. So that perspective is important so that we can compare where we were and where we are heading. And if in case of an alarming situation, we can generate some sort of control measure to solve a particular issue. So these theoretical or practical subjects, they help to develop the world views. These world views help us to generate values. Those values are later on used up for generating or devising some policies which are beneficial for the mankind. So to generate the policy, there comes the role of people from the social science background. Like for example, people who are studying the effect of humans on the ecological parameters. So like for example, if there is too much of deforestation in a particular area, deforestation means cutting down trees and increase in pollution. All these causes are caused by increase in human population. So humans are very, they play a very important role in creating or destroying the environment, we can say. So suppose if there is an earthquake, and we know that, okay, this particular area is earthquake prone and we want to make a policy. So there comes the role of people from the social sciences background. So they help in devising the policies by identifying various stakeholder groups. Like who are the stakeholders? Any person who is concerned with something is generally known as the stakeholder. For example, in a forest, you can have a forest department which takes care of all the activities going in a forest area. So the forest department forms one stakeholder group. There are people who live in the vicinity of the forest, like the locals, they form the another stakeholder. Likewise, you have other people or that may be directly or indirectly associated with a particular aspect of an environment. So these policies will help to form different types of, they will identify different types of stakeholder groups. So once the area where the policy needs, for which the policy needs to be devised is worked out, then comes the role of the people from the arts and sciences. So they help in devising the technology and they design the technology in such a way that it can solve the environmental problems. But the branch of biology or the branch of science that directly relates to the environmental problem is environmental sciences or the environmental physics or environmental chemistry or ecology. So the people from these domain of study, they bring about our main focus or the direct focus. They help us draw the attention to the environmental problem. So in order to solve a particular environment such as water pollution, we need to involve the people from all sorts of area like humanities, social sciences, applied arts and sciences, and even the ecology. So this is how we see that, you know, the environmental studies has a multidisciplinary nature. Now we will look at the components of environment. So there are basically two components of the environment. It can be biotic component or abiotic component. So what is a biotic component? Anything that is non-living makes up the abiotic component. So bio means life, a means absent. So non-living components in your area. So the components which surrounds us, but these are non-living, these include physical factors like, for example, soil, which is non-living, water, air, temperature, and sunlight. So these are abiotic components. For example, if you're sitting in a room, in the same room, you have table, you have air in your room, you have water, drinking water in your room. So these non-living components in your room will make up the abiotic components. And what are the biotic components? The biotic components which are living are the components which are living. Like, for example, if you are sitting in your room, you are representing the biotic component. There are other microbes which are suspended, which you cannot see. They are there in the environment. Even on your clothes, there are many types of microbes that are not visible to the naked eye. So in the air that is in your room, that can also contain many biotic components which are not visible to the naked eye. So anything that is living in a particular area makes up the biotic component. So there are some other ways of defining these abiotic or biotic components of an environment. So there are three terms which are used: atmosphere, hydrosphere, and lithosphere. So this is a picture of Earth, and in this picture you can see three components which are indicated by these three names. So what is atmosphere? Atmosphere is the blanket of air that surrounds the Earth globe. And the part of the land, right, which is forming the continent on the Earth, they represent lithosphere. And then there is 70% of the entire Earth surface is water, and it is also known as hydrosphere. So the different aspects or the detailed aspects of each one of these would be discussed in the next slide. So now we will look at the different layers of atmosphere. In this picture you can see that the different layers of the atmosphere has been depicted. So if you start from 0 kilometer to 10 kilometer, this layer is known as troposphere. Furthermore, if you go higher up from 10 to 30 kilometers, it forms a stratosphere, followed by 30 to 50 kilometer forms a mesosphere. So we can say the entire blanket of the atmosphere is further characterized, is further divided into different layers. So first of all, what is atmosphere? It is the layer of gases surrounding the planet. Atmosphere protects life by creating pressure, allowing for liquid water to exist on the Earth's surface. It absorbs ultraviolet solar radiation, warming the Earth's surface through heat retention, that is also known as greenhouse effect. So these are some important roles played by the atmosphere. Atmosphere also regulates the temperature variation, you know, the temperature extremes between day and night. We have seen that, you know, on the moon, we know that, you know, since there is no atmosphere, the difference in the night temperature and the day temperature is too much. So because of that great difference in the temperature, the life cannot exist there. So the presence of atmosphere is beneficial because it regulates the difference between day and night temperature. For this, we have this term that is used, that is known as the diurnal temperature variation. So if you look at by volume, the dry air, if you take the 100 ml of air, it will contain 78% of nitrogen. So nitrogen is the most abundant gas in the atmosphere, followed by oxygen, which is approximately 21%. And then you have argon, then you have 0.4% carbon dioxide. And there are some other small amount of gases that are also present. Also, there is a variable amount of vapor. Water vapor, and on an average around 1% at sea level and 0.4% over the entire atmosphere is water vapor. So there are five layers, as you can see, in that makes up the atmosphere. One of the very important point to mention here is that in the stratosphere there is an ozone layer which is found, which protects us from the harmful ultraviolet solar radiation. Why the ultraviolet solar radiation is harmful? Because if it reaches Earth's surface, it can cause damage in the DNA, which can lead to the cancer, the skin cancer. So in the stratosphere, there is a layer which is known as ozone layer, It protects us from the harmful effects of ultraviolet light or the UV light. Now we look at the hydrosphere. So what is a hydrosphere? A hydrosphere is the total amount of water that is present on the planet. So it will include all the water that is there. It may be underground water, it can be water in the river, water in the ocean, even in the glaciers. A planet's hydrosphere can be in the form of liquid, vapor or ice. For example, there on the Earth, the liquid water exists on the surface in the form of oceans, lakes and rivers. So these are some pictures here. You can see on the picture number 1 indicates an ocean. Picture number 2 is of a river. Picture 3 is of a glacier. And then you have a picture of a lake. So these are the different kinds of water bodies. The frozen part of the Earth atmosphere is made up of ice. And there are different terms that are used to explain that. Like for example, glaciers, ice caps and icebergs. The frozen part of the hydrosphere has also got its own name, and that is cryosphere. Water moves through the hydrosphere in a particular cycle known as water cycle. Water collects in the cloud and then falls on the earth in the form of rain and snow. So there is a continuous cycling of water molecule in different forms, either in the form of a liquid or a gas or a solid form. So this water cycle helps to maintain the flow of water in the different parts of the earth, the different parts of the globe. Look at the lithosphere. In this picture, you can see if you take the slice of the entire earth, then you can see that the entire portion is divided into three parts. So it can be core, mantle and crust. So lithosphere is the solid outer part of the earth. Lithosphere includes the brittle upper portion of the mantle and the crust. So what is lithosphere? The brittle part. Brittle means which is easy to break. Which part and it has come from the some portion of mantle and the crust. So little bit of crust like this portion that you can see in the gray, and a little bit of the mantle for the topmost portion of that. So that is known as lithosphere. Lithosphere is bounded by the atmosphere above. So on the top obviously you have the air that is surrounding. So that is bounded by the atmosphere above and the asthenosphere below. So what is asthenosphere, which you can see here, right? So this entire gray portion represents lithosphere, and the lithosphere on the lower side has asthenosphere, and on the top side it is surrounded by atmosphere. Although the rocks of the lithosphere are still considered elastic, they are not viscous. The asthenosphere is viscous, and the lithosphere asthenosphere boundary, which is abbreviated as LAB, is the point where the geologist or the rheologist are interested. So who are rheologists? These are the scientists who study the flow of matter. So there is this zone which is known as LAB. So what is LAB? LAB refers to lithosphere asthenosphere boundary. First of all, what is asthenosphere? One of the topmost layer of the mantle is asthenosphere. And then you have, and above that you have the lithosphere. So this margin or the boundary which lies between the lithosphere and the asthenosphere is known as LAB. And this is the region where most of the geologists are interested. Why they are interested? Because this is the portion that marks, you know, there is a difference in the ductility between the two layers of the upper mantle. So if you just look at this mantle portion, then you have different zones which are indicated by different shades of oranges. They have difference. They are different in terms of their ductility as well as their in viscosity. So the lithosphere is far ductile. So why I am discussing all these points here? Because the main purpose of discussing these aspects was to understand that the lithosphere is far less ductile than the asthenosphere. So that we can compare it with the asthenosphere. The ductility. Ductility means its ability to stretch is known as ductility. So that's why we call that the lithosphere is more fragile. So we can break it. So there are two types of lithosphere, oceanic lithosphere and the continental lithosphere. So oceanic obviously means that portion of the lithosphere which is at the bottom of the sea. And the other ones which are actually forming at the bottom of the land portion. So that is known as the continental lithosphere. Oceanic lithosphere is associated with oceanic crust and is slightly denser than the continental lithosphere. Now we will talk about the most important component of the environment, and it is known as biosphere. So what is biosphere? Now we have been talking about the atmosphere. In the atmosphere, there are again two components, biotic and abiotic. Like for example, all the birds that are flying in the air atmosphere, they form the biotic. All the microbes that are suspended in the atmosphere, they form the biotic component. Likewise, there are gases, there are dust particles which are suspended in the air, so they form the abiotic component. So atmosphere also has biotic component as well as the abiotic component. Likewise, in the lithosphere, like the portion that is the land part of the environment is known that is lithosphere, it also has biotic and abiotic. Like all the plants and animals, microbes, etc. that are living on the land, they form the biotic component. And all the other like soil components and all the non-living components that they are there on the atmosphere, on the lithosphere, they form abiotic. Likewise, in the water body, we have water, which is abiotic, and all the water life forms are biotic, like all the fish and all the other aquatic organisms, they form the biotic component. So it's not like that one biotic component from one portion from here will not interact with the other components of the other parts of the environment. Like for example, if there is a bird, so that bird which lives or fly in the atmosphere will also come and drink water and will also come and feed on plants which are growing on land. So there is a continuous interaction going on between the biotic components from all the three from all the three places, that is the atmosphere, lithosphere and hydrosphere. So what is biosphere? So biosphere is basically that portion is that stratum of life surface that shows that there is a continuous interaction going on between the biotic components and abiotic components across atmosphere, lithosphere and hydrosphere. So biosphere, which is relatively thin life supporting stratum of Earth's surface, extends from few kilometers to the atmosphere to the deep sea vents of ocean. The biosphere is a global ecosystem composed of living organisms as well as non-living organisms, and that also deals with the interactions that are going on between the living components and non-living components. So the global environment, you can say the global ecosystem, where the biotic and abiotic components from the different parts of the globe are interacting with each other, that forms biosphere. So if you like this e-lesson, you can press the like button, you can subscribe to our channel, you can share this so that it can benefit students in some sort. If you want to get a copy of this presentation, you can subscribe to our mailing list, which is available at the website www.botanypedia.com. Thank you for watching this lesson.